So,
and that's what I think is interesting about, you know, this companion metaphor. It's not just that companion that knows your goals, but puts them in the context of
societal goals. Many
other goals. Yes. You know, you mentioned just like a mechanical, you might save some on mechanical, but it costs you this much on electrical. That's within a company. But yeah, and then the broader sustainability goals around the world. So you mentioned one thing, though, I wanted to touch on about the decision being that data point, that that's not what we have today, and that would maybe be the piece that would help connect us. Can you just comment a little?
Well, decision-centered thinking is something that when I first started monkeying with it in 89, it was based on a simple recognition, and that is that everything we do is either designed to allow us to make a decision or as a consequence of one we made. So it acts as a singularity. It's a way to take everything that we did and attach it to that, and everything that was a consequence of it and attach it to it. I can reproduce it. I can teach it to other people. I can use it for forensic purposes. It's an odd thing in that it is intrinsic in so much of what we accomplish and so much we value. It's also intrinsic to our hierarchy of systems. So. But yet, there isn't any system in the world that currently looks at decision as a data type and organizes what we do around that. If we did, we would be able to revisit our decisions in toto. The answer was no. I don't think I learned much out of that. What can you tell me about why it was no? Now, all of a sudden, in a very rapid fashion, I can learn the whys and be able to say, now, wait a minute, that why was a valid why 12 years ago. It is no longer a valid why. And so now we can decouple, we can decompose the decisions that we continue to make. We still answer yes to this. But we do that because of tradition. We haven't decomposed how we got to yes as the answer on a recurring basis and say, no, that's in this context, that assumption, that constraint is no longer operable. And so it can't be yes. And the literal use of tradition, that's what I was trying to mention in the talk, is the idea that we have buried in a million places things where the reasons why those decisions were made is completely missing, is an insane circumstance. Because it means that the effort to reconstitute that is high enough that we just keep doing the same dumb thing.
Don't learn.
And we have the opportunity to learn, we have the information to learn, we may even have tools to do it, but we didn't capture the decision base in order to be able to understand when it's been violated. If we start using a decision-centered view going forward, then you have the opportunity to make that organic, to make it something that moves with the context. Context is a terribly powerful word, because we have many rules that we apply in context that was never intended. And that's an equally difficult problem. So the word organic is very powerful in this, because our world is changing far too fast to rely on any static. I mean, it's what killed ERP systems. People have spent billions of dollars putting in ERP systems and completely forgot about the fact that many, many, many elements of it were predicated on a set of rules that were hard-coded into the systems. And now things have changed. Their financial circumstances, their markets, whatever. Look at some of the dumbest things. For example, in the United States, huge numbers of people are moving into the downtown area. It's nice. Urbanization, gentrification, put it however you want. But it's kind of a cute thing. But, okay, now wait a minute. Was anything assumed in the services, such as the water, the sewer, the pumping stations, where's a gas station, those little minor details? Did anybody make any assumptions about that? Yeah, they made hundreds of assumptions. Captured in a billion places, we'll never be able to decompose. So we can't undo the past, but we can begin to start that capture. And in the past, one of the great luxuries we have is that the young people today don't view a computer as a tool. They don't view it as an appliance. For them, it's an appendage. And
a companion.
You bet. It's getting close to a companion, especially when it talks social media. But the main thing is that it, their facility with it is staggering. And right now we're handing them tools that are so archaic and so stupid. I mean, I went to the University of Texas, Austin. Very good school. Great school. And I went in and I said, I want to see, and I need to see your accounting systems. And they trotted out a 24-year-old green screen terminal-based accounting system. And I nearly got sick. And I thought, because the system does what they need to do. That's fine. That's great. They've invested a lot of money in it. But the average student intern that walks in there kind of walks in there like this. Because it's terrifying to imagine working on a system that is so horrifying compared to what they could do if they were just given something that would work in an environment that they are great with, really great with.
Now, do you guys think the solution will be found by that student population? The people we're trying to teach will teach us and help
They're
us figure this out? Because you talked a lot, John, about when you look at that history of these computing innovations, so much of it came from students. So what kind of role do you...
Well, there's a wonderful thing about being a student and not in a job with a goal someone else has created for you. You can be free to think of something. And a power you have, which you don't appreciate, is that many people, usually older than you, tried a lot of things and things failed. But as John says, the context is constantly changing. You're free from all those old negative reactions. The usual thing in any organization when someone has a new idea is to say, we tried that, it won't work. But they leave out the context in which they tried it. So it's just, we couldn't move this vehicle, or we couldn't get the information there. Well, now, today you can. So people are freed from a burden of false understanding. And you're also, more or less constitutionally, optimistic. Let's try it. Let's see. And what could be, what's wrong with trying it? So that style, combined with new insights, and every year we learn so much more about what are the capabilities of the biological organisms and how can we affect their design. We learn so much more about materials. We learn so much more about how things interact with each other. So all rules, all the old learning, I should not say is wrong. Remember, human beings themselves still are quite capable of killing each other over doctrinal differences now. This is something very deep to understand. How do other humans think, and why do they have these feelings they do, and how do they cause others to be viewed as having no value? This is fundamentally, ethically, and morally at the bottom of how we use all our new insights to do new things. But the tools we have to be applied in new and interesting and intricate ways are just exploding. All of us, many people have problems with their hands because they type. Why would I ever type if I could speak? It's just why would I use a mouse if I can touch? Why are these tablets all of a sudden capturing? Because a normal human being has hands and likes to touch them, and different cultures do more and others do less, but every human on Earth uses their body to express and communicate, and why are these stupid computers not appreciating it? Well, now they're beginning to, so they're coming alive. As we ease communication, new forms of art appear, new ways of capturing your emotions appear. So it sounds a little odd for the techo crowd to be talking about how important emotions are, but when you really get down to it, John's presentation had an emotional component to it, which said to all these very smart and technically competent people, you need to be emotionally involved in the directions our societies are taking. And John said, I feel worried, and that's an emotion, about the inevitable consequences of unsustainable decisions we've taken.